Yes, so we are ready for the next session here. Again, we have Sergio del Amo from OCI, and he's ready to present how you tame your browser with JEP. JEP is an awesome framework. I'll leave the stage.
Yeah, hi everyone. My name is Sergio del Amo. As Soren said, I work for a company named Object Computing, which is a company behind the Grails, actually maintaining Grails. Punit Bell, who is one of the persons who is actively involved in contributing to Grails, working with us. Company behind Micronaut. Both frameworks have a long history of using JEP, especially Grails, which had a Grails plugin to make it even easier to write JEP tests in a Grails application. Micronaut is also straightforward. I had a talk an hour ago about Micronaut and Groovy, and I have some slides about how to integrate JEP in a Micronaut application. So if you didn't attend that, but that's your cup of tea, I will upload the talks of the previous session probably tomorrow. Those will be available. So this talk is an introduction to JEP. The easiest way to reach me is sergiodelamo.com. I'm not going to spend more time in talking about me. So what is JEP? Let me turn off Siri, which apparently understood Hey Siri now. So JEP is a Groovy layer on top of Webdriver, and makes, for me, it makes joyful to work with Webdriver again. Has a couple of interesting patterns as well, such as the page object pattern, which is something that I've seen in many projects not being used, because for whatever reason, we write worse quality code for test, where we don't mind a lot of duplication, we don't mind a lot of code which is impossible to understand when we come back to it, and we don't use like class is only available in the test class path, just to have like a nicer test suite, easier to maintain. And this is where page object comes into a scene, and they will make your tests much, much nicer to maintain. Nowadays I use JEP mostly for acceptance testing. So basically tests which needs to like start a browser, and you need to verify that and the navigation is possible as you define it. But I have used in the past a lot JEP for web scraping. So whenever you want to automate a browser, JEP is a great option. You need, for whatever reason, to automate like generating some reports, you need to log into an intranet and clicking a button to download an Excel file, you can automate that. So don't think JEP is just for test. JEP is whenever you want to automate your browser, and that's an option. I found that even if many people that do like scraping, they use like Python. Personally, JEP tests, they can be a bit more slow. But what I found is that typically speed is not the limitation in scraping. So the limitation is the ability to keep those scraping code bases easy to maintain, and that's a good characteristic of JEP. So yeah, if you are into any of these use cases, give JEP a try. Nowadays, jQuery is not as famous as it used to be, but when JEP was first introduced, almost all programmers who have done any backend code, we had like experience with jQuery, and jQuery had some interesting concepts around selection, which in that moment they were revolutionary. And JEP uses those concepts for content selection. JEP is an open source project. It has probably one of the best documentations for an open source project, what they call the Book of JEP. You can find the source code in GitHub. There is like a mailing list. It's like a mailing list with not a lot of mails, which is something that I appreciate. So it's like a mailing list that you enjoy to be part of. Currently, the project is stewarded by Marcin Erdman. He's a great guy and I think a great project lead. The project was originally created by Luke Daly. Typically, if you want to use like JEP in a testing framework, you will use like you will not use like the JEP core dependency, but you will use like JEP Spock or JEP the unit which have like a transitive dependency to Spock to JEP core. I normally use only JEP with Spock, so because Spock is my framework of choice for testing. So, yep, if you are into testing, you will need to choose the dependency that you put into your class path, depending on the test framework that you use. So Webdriver has become the de facto standard for browser automation. It has an API such as this one. Like you have like a driver, you tell the driver to go to a web page, and then you have like selectors. JEP has a lot of DSL that we've seen examples that makes this much, much easier. But one thing important to understand is that JEP doesn't talk to the browser, it's Webdriver, the one who talks to the browser. So when you are using JEP, you still are, you are on the shoulders of the giant. You have the Webdriver API available if you need it. So it's as easy as doing like a browser.driver, and you have the driver there. So yeah, don't think that because if you are using JEP, you are missing out in the Webdriver APIs. You are not. So if you need to use the Webdriver APIs, you can. So typically, you will have apart from the JEP dependency, you will need to have like the Selenium dependency as well. There are different, so it's like a Selenium support dependency, but you will need like a dependency per driver. There is a wonderful Gradle plugin called Webdriver binaries plugin. So if you go to plugins.gradle.org and you search for Webdriver binaries plugin, you will find it. It's written by the same person who maintains JEP, so it's written by Marcin Erdman. So you know that the plugin is going to play really well with JEP, and it does. And I would say, like, whenever I use JEP in test, 100% of these projects, they have this plugin applied. This is like jQuery code. jQuery, so this is like, this will select a div with the ID of footer. And when the selection that jQuery brought into the table was much better, so much simpler to understand the next path, that was the inspiration for JEP. So in JEP, there is, you can use like the dollar, like you use in jQuery. There is actually a method with the dollar character as the method name, so which is funny because I don't know, like it's not like a character we typically use in methods, but that's the method there, and you do like selections that you are in jQuery. So the code that you have in front of you is not like jQuery code, is JEP code. The API is not like 100% the one-to-one to the jQuery one, but it's similar. So if you want to do things like you want to select like an element with an ID or an element with a class, all those selections are possible. And if you have experience with jQuery in the past, JEP will feel natural to you. So we are in the Groovy track, so I don't have to tell you about the benefits of Groovy. But one thing I would like to say is that Jeb really uses the dynamic characteristics and the of Groovy. It uses a lot of delegation. It uses a lot of method not found handling. So Jeb really is a framework that I don't know if we will be capable with other programming languages. So it really, I think it's probably one of the best examples of the Groovy features applied to solve a problem. So for example, there is like the method drive, which you can add like, you see these two add and search, these are all using delegation in Groovy. To delegate those calls to browser. So the browser class has a method called to. And this is something that you will see in a lot of tests, which I don't know why this caught up, but you will see a lot of tests where parentheses are not used, right? So when you call like in the browser to Google homepage, in Groovy, you don't need to specify Google homepage.class. And the class literal is optional. So that's typical in Groovy code. We don't use that, but the parentheses are optional, and they are not. But when the compiler is able to basically understand that the parentheses are redundant, a lot of JEP code you will see like, especially with add checkers and two, which are actually two methods, parentheses are not used. So even if this seems like magic, this is like using all the delegation that I was talking before. So page objects, this is something, and this is probably the message that I would like to get through in this talk is, if you are using JEP, please use page objects, because they are really easy to create, and they will basically decompose your test into different objects, and you will have selection encapsulated in a single place. So if in the future you touch your HTML and you need to change an ID element, the ID value of an element, you will have to change it all in one place. You will have to change it all in the page object. So in general, in all my tests, in the Spock specification, there is no like any JEP selection there. All the JEP selections are done in page objects or in page or in modules, which we will see shortly. So the idea is that the code above is more fragile and more difficult to maintain than having a method in a page object with that selection, or even better, to use a static content closure that we will see in other slides. Basically, it's programming well, right? We all understand the value of having objects to encapsulate certain things in our main class path. Why not bring those concepts to the test class path as well, right? So yeah, it's basically don't be lazy in your test class path and try to have like an easy to maintain test suite for you, because it really doesn't, it's not like you are putting a lot more effort in the first place. It's just getting into the habit of creating page objects whenever you have to do like content selection. One thing here is there are many objects in Grails where in JEP, sorry, that when you do like browser two, they return a page. Or when you do like a browser, there's like a browser.page where you can actually change like the page which JEP uses to see the HTML through the lens. I sometimes think about pages as blueprints. So you basically are telling like, I want to see this, the current HTML that is rendered by the browser through this blueprint. And you can change it. So you can have like multiple pages for the same HTML page. So let me give you an example. So imagine I have here this Grails application. This could be whatever kind of application. It doesn't have to be Grails, it can be Spring Boot, it can be MyCode, it can be Quarkus, any kind of, it can be a non-Java, it can be, you can use JEP for testing non-Java code, right? So I have written like tests for a website that were created with PHP. So I have this page which has like a form with one field, one text field to create. It has a button. It has like a menu. And the URL is... So the way you will write, you could write a JEP page for this is as follows. So you extend from JEP.page. So you extend it from that class. And there's like a DSL for doing certain things. So there's like a static URL. That's basically where you, if you remember, the page was /room/create. So you basically tell like, this is the URL when I tell the browser, like browser.to, and I tell the class create room page, when I tell the browser to go to this page, it will go to this URL. The at has a closure, and if the closure evaluates to true, this is what is called in the DSL the at checker. So basically, I can do like a browser to this page, and if the at checker fails, I will know that something was wrong, that the condition is not being fulfilled. Something being, since I am Spanish and English is obviously not my primary language, I have an appreciation for internationalization. So whenever you are working with a website that they have multiple languages, don't write ad checkers based on the title of the browser, such as the one that I am displaying in this example, because the title of the website of the page probably changes because of the language, right? So typically what I will normally do is I use an ID for the body element in HTML. And typically what I verify is that the body has that ID. So that remains the same between languages. So it's good to check the copy, but the copy should be checked in a localized state. So it should not be checked like... to verify that you are in the login page, because in Spanish it may be entrar instead of login, right? So just to recap, the ad checker, I am checking that the browser title is create room. With the URL, I am basically telling the browser where to go to when I tell the browser to go to this page. Then I have a DSL for the content. I have like a closure, and here I have I typically call the elements, the DSL is like, you have like a name. So I typically call my elements like something element or something field. And then you have a closure for the selection. And here I am telling like, this is like a jQuery selection kind of, where I am saying like, select the elements with of type input and the name attribute. So if you remember in HTML, like inputs, and they typically have, they should have a name, right? This is the thing that is the key that is submitted when you submit the form. So I am using like the IT. So this will be like a parameter that they pass to the closure. And for the selection, I'm going to apply this module. So we will see like modules are like another way of modularizing the context selection. And if you see there, the populate method in the bottom of this slide, it actually calls input field and it supplies like a name. So if I want to select like the name, I could take past here the name, and that will be basically the field that is selected. And then because I apply the text module, the text input module, I can like do like dot text that will call like the set text method. And I can set the, I can populate my field, right? Then you can click elements. For example, here I select the save button with input submit, and I can call dot click. And one thing that you will see here is, so I am selecting there in the slide what I just said, I am selecting the create button with that input submit, right? I am, you see I can select by the type of the element and then attributes. So the attribute type is of type submit. JEP modules, in my example, the navigation, I am selecting a div element with a class nav. So this was div.nav. This is selecting a div element with class nav, and I am applying the module nav. The module nav is a module that I have created, and it looks like this. So it's a module where I can, if you see, I have some methods called home, rooms and extras, and that calls another method called select, which in turn calls the nap link method, which basically, if you see this, shows another really powerful JEP, which is selectors. So you can select like a link whose text contains a certain closure parameter that I am supplying. So I can say, like, when I do like select home, I am basically searching the links which text contains home, right? So it's really powerful, really allows you to, text selection. It has like things like, here I am showcasing contains, but you can do like starts with, etc. So really, really powerful for selection. And modules are navigations, footers, those are typical examples, but also tables. So whenever you have like content that repeats through the page, you can map that with a JEP module. So one thing that I didn't say is JEP modules are classes which extend from JEP dot module. The class is called module, and it's in the package JEP, and they have a DSL similar to the one that you will find in pages. And here what you are seeing in this slide is I am selecting all the rows in the tbody element of the table which has the ID book results, and I am applying the book row module, and the book row module has like a couple of utility selectors which allow me like to select the first cell. So you think this is a row, the first column will have like the title of the book, and the second column will have like the author of the book. So this is exactly what I am doing. So you see, I am like using the DSL with some closure parameters to have like really succinct code and being able to select content. So then in your test, this is how it looks like, right? It's really like, if you use pages and you use pages a lot, your test, they don't look like Webdriver API tests. They don't look like JEP tests. They look like you are testing like your use case. You are testing your application, right? So I am testing what I am testing here, that in this page I have two books, and that for the titles is this thing and the author is this thing. So when you use pages, the HTML gets out of the way, basically. Another thing, at least I enjoy when I wrote this one, I did a JEP talk a long time ago in the, I believe it's the Krakow in Poland, the Groovy user group, and they use Meetup for their group, and Meetup has this navigation, which is like a really common navigation that is present in almost every website in the world. Where the last item in the navigation is like a link to go to the next page, and when you are in like in the second page, you have like also like a button to go back to the previous page, right? So I created a module. This is like now this is deprecated, so you will have like you will apply the module at the end, but this is like the way it was done before. Where I will apply this module to this unordered list, which was the navigation of Meetup. And I created actually an interface, which was easy to understand, right? It doesn't like an interface that you could use for every website, like have like a two page, go to the third page or go to the fourth page. And then I have a method to go to the next page, a method to go to the previous page, and a couple of auxiliary methods to help me out if this thing was in the first page or in the last one. And this is how my module looked like. So you see, I was implementing the interface. I forgot the implements interface here, but this implements the interface, and this basically select the links, and it's able to use common CSS classes, which are used in many paginations, which are like selected or nav next or nav previous, to basically go to the to navigate. And here I show also one thing. If you see this next link, which requires false, So in JEP, you can, so in my navigation, in my pagination, when I am in the first page, the previous link button is not in the page, right? So it's like an optional element. And in JEP, you can say like, this is like, maybe it's not there. And you do that with that require false. So really nice. You can have like some ways to tell when you are like mapping the content that some parts of the page are optional. You can extend modules and pages. So yeah. Again, JEP available in many testing frameworks. A really nice feature, and a feature that many people don't use, is reporting. And it's pretty awesome, actually. JEP allows you to take as, you can, instead of extending, for example, when you are using Spock, instead of extending from JEP spec, you can extend from JEP reporting spec. And when each of the specification finish, it will basically take a screenshot, or if the specification fails, it will take a screenshot and do an HTML dump. And this is really good because it allows you to see where the page failed or what happened. And yeah, for scrapers, for example, I use this a lot when, sometimes scrapers failed and I was not like in front of the computer seeing when the scraper failed, and it allowed me like to see what actually happened, right? If, I don't know, like if something didn't load in an iframe, got freezed or something like that. So I have shown already like the Navigator API through examples. So the Navigator API has typically this kind of syntax where you have like a CSX selector, the index, so you can say like, give me like the first development or the third development. So I have not shown that, but you can like do that. And then you are like, so I have shown like standard attributes, but you can select like non-standard attributes as well. As like ranges, for example, if you want to select the first three divs, and you can also like do like some operations with text that I saw before. So really powerful selection again. Nowadays that every browser that you are probably gonna test against supports CSS3 selectors, I encourage you to use those because those selectors are really fast in the browsers, because the browsers need to paint the page as soon as possible, right? So they will be really, really fast. So whenever possible, use like CSS lookups because they will be incredibly fast. And if you are using like a JavaScript frontend and you have like non-standard attributes in your HTML elements, you can match those with JEP as well. The text as well allows for regular expressions. So yeah, you can go crazy with this. Regular expressions are awesome, but they are like, use them with caution as well. Predicates. So if you work with JEP and you think something is not possible, check documentation, because chances are it is possible. And also similar methods to the one that you are used in jQuery are there, like to navigate, basically to navigate the DOM, like select previous element, select next element, and this kind of thing. You can like, this is like a fluid API. You can concatenate methods, right? So you can have like select all paragraphs and then select the classes with the elements with the class listing. So yeah, just I typically don't use like don't go crazy. I like to. It depends of how you use JEP, right? If you are like writing the test, but you don't have control over the HTML, then sometimes you have to go crazy. If you have control, I sometimes use IDs for elements, and I use like classes for styling, but I don't use a lot of IDs for styling, and mostly I use like IDs for like selection in tests. I already discussed this about the optional content with require false. So that's completely possible. Another thing that is what happens if you need to test like a web page, but some of the content in the web page is load dynamically. JEP has like a couple of things. It has, you can define like an element with weight true, and there is like a default timeout that you can configure how long JP is going to wait for that element to be present until it fails. And there is also like a wait for which takes like a closure, and you can like pass also like the as the first element of this method, you can pass like the seconds. So you can like wait until an element appears in the page. So if you are using like loading some content into a page with JavaScript, you can wait with a nice DSL. The two method you will use in browser, so basically browser.to, and you pass like the class of the, typically you will pass the class of the of a JEP page where you would like to go to. And it says the page object. So it says, it sets the lens through which JEP understand the HTML that is currently rendered. And yeah, this is an important thing. So I saw an easy example, which is, okay, you showed me like book does create, and that's, but what happens when in part of my URL, I have like a path variable, which maybe is an ID or a parameter that changes, right? So you can overwrite a method called convert to path, which takes like an array of objects and the way the URL is built is the equation that is in the top of the slide is basically URL equals base URL. That's the base URL that you set the browser. So typically, when you are using this for testing, if you are like testing like a Java app which starts in localhost 8080, the base URL will be like HTTP localhost 8080. The URL in this example will be like room edit. So this will be like the URL of edit room page, and then the result of convert to path. So basically, that will be the equation that you can use to calculate the URL. So if you have like a dynamic URL, don't worry. That's already baked into the framework. How about handling like keyboard interaction? So if you can have, there's like a couple of nice things. So there's like the, there's some operator overloading to like ease like inputting characters into a text field. And you can do things like for modern elements, like sliders. You can like interact with sliders and move them. So there are like really powerful things. I think I don't know if we have, should go into, so there are like many, many other things. One thing that is cool is that I have used and I am amazed of how cool it is so let's say you are working with an application which allows the user to download an Excel file, right? And you want to verify, you need like to log in and then download the Excel file, right? And that request to download the Excel file will fail unless the security cookies are present there, right? So JEP, and typically this code I have seen in many applications that is, we don't have any test for this code, right? We don't test that the contents of the Excel file are correct. So it's easy to write a test in JEP that verifies like, you can download like a PDF or an Excel file. And then you can basically, you download the file and you basically can inspect the contents of the file. So if you have a code that you are downloading files, which is a lot of applications have, right? Like it's like a typical export option. Don't think that you cannot test this code. You can, and it's actually pretty easy to do with JEP. I have an example about hidden content and mouse over events. But I want to leave some time for questions. Is it possible to run JEP test in parallel in one JVM? I don't know the answer to that question. Typically, the way I do it is, I think it is. I think Thomas Lin, I believe he did it for this hotel project. He had like a massive test suite. I typically don't do it, so there's like a cost of instantiating. Like, so Paul has done it. So if with HTML Unit, if you use like the Gradle parallel through, it will try to parallelize those tests. When the browser starts, I think it uses the same canvas for all of those. If you are like, using a Firefox or something like that by default. So I normally start like one browser per test suite. So I wrote this example a long time ago, actually, I believe it was in an old YRConf, to show that you can go crazy with JEP. So I have this page. The idea is you want to, you can interact with JavaScript in JEP directly. So the idea here is when I put the mouse over the logo, the paragraph below will appear, right? So this is the HTML page. It has an image, and you see it has these two paragraphs, which have they have the attribute display none, right? And if you see there, the it uses jQuery. No, sorry, it doesn't use jQuery. It uses just plain JavaScript. It checks that the element with ID OCI low, which is the ID of the image, is present, and basically register a mouse over function callback, which calls in turn another JavaScript function, which basically searches for the paragraphs and changes the display and the CSS display attribute from none to block, right? So basically, if you put the mouse over the image due to this JavaScript code, the image, the paragraphs are displayed, right? So if you write this test in JEP, right? Like I go to instantiate the browser, I drive the browser to localhost. This was running in a local Apache in my computer in port 888. And I try to select the paragraphs. And I verify in my den, I verify that the paragraphs list is not empty, that will fail. And it will fail because by default, you cannot select hidden content, right? So I cannot test that these paragraphs are actually there. So how do I write a test for this? So there are a couple of things. JEP exposes this JS. The browser has this JS method, which allows you to invoke like JavaScript methods directly. So what I'm doing there, I'm calling a JavaScript method directly. So this show OCI description is not a coincidence that it's the method name there, show OCI description. So this is the first way to do this, make this test pass, is call a JavaScript method directly from within your JEP code, which is kind of crazy. Another way to do this, which is like probably more like the real code, is move the mouse to the element, right? So we have this interact method where we can tell move the mouse to the element with this. Basically, we are selecting an element with the ID OCI log, right? So we are basically moving to the image, and that makes the paragraphs appear.
So the next session actually starts in 30 seconds.
Okay, I'm gonna just.
You can wrap up.
So this is the last crazy thing is here. What I'm doing is I am including jQuery in a page that didn't have jQuery. You see, I am basically appending a new element to the body, and basically what I am appending is the script that basically loads jQuery. And you see this js.execute. Basically, I am executing a jQuery selection there, and I am showing the paragraphs. So yeah, I hope this gives you like the kind of flexibility and the kind of power that is available in JEP. And I had some other slides, but I'm gonna end it here. Just one last thing is, if you want to test, I don't have here like even a Windows machine in my house, right? So if I wanted to test like to run my test suites against the Internet Explorer, I could use these providers, these either Source Labs or Browser Stacks. They're like online providers where you can say like they have like a really nice integration with JEP, and actually they are like the JEP test suite is run with them. They have like a some free for open source initiatives, so you can run like run my test with Firefox. I don't know the version numbers that are changing all the time, but you can basically run against the different browsers versions. Nowadays, it seems things are better than in the past, but still, depending on your case, you may need to run your test against multiple different vendors and different operating systems and resolution, and this allows you to do that. So yeah, thanks everyone for attending. And if anyone has any questions, I will try to stay a couple of more minutes and go through the chat and answer them.
Thank you very much. That was a great talk. I really enjoyed it.
Thank you, sir. JEP is one of my favorite open source projects. It's really amazing.
Yeah, it's really cool. I use it far less than I ought to.
I use it quite a lot. But yeah, it's a project that deserves more love probably than what it has.
Well, very nice. And you should scroll through and see if there are any good questions.
So there is a question from Simon. Can we use JEP to test the website with web browser that are not compatible with the operating system, Safari or IDE Edge or Linux? So I think the answer is no.
But you can if you use a service like BrowserStack. BrowserStack can actually be used from JEP.
For Safari, for example, you don't actually like. So every Mac has a Safari, right? And Safari is quite a pain with Webdriver. So I find, but you can use it as well. You just have to enable like some developer options in Safari, and you are able to run the test. I have run the test in Safari. I use Safari. This is my browser of choice, but. Yeah, in general, for JEP test, I normally default to Firefox. But nowadays, it seems everything is written in Chrome, so many people use Chrome. Yeah, that browser stack.
And I seem to remember there's another service like that, but I just don't recall the name of it.
Source Labs.
Source Labs, yes. And they have a driver as well.
Yeah. Let me paste the link into the. This one. JEP has like an integration with both of them.
I think that both of them actually allows you to JEP tests browsers on a cell phone as well.
As well, yeah.
Yeah, so it's really versatile.
Yeah, if you are testing, so one of the things is, I think I have a blog post in my blog is, One day I lost a lot of hours of my day because I was running tests with a headless browser, and by default the canvas was like a cell phone kind of canvas. So if you are testing like a browser with a responsive design, If you are like testing, I don't know, like you want to test like with 1,000 pixels wide, you can tell like there is like a, I believe it's like browser.manage, browser.driver.manage maximize, something like that. So you can change like the window size, right? So if you have like a responsive web design, you can test both scenarios, like in a 300 pixel wide and in a regular big desktop wide.
Nice. Well, I think we should close this down. Very good talk, and very nice to see you again.
Yeah.
Same. I hope we can do it again next year in Great Conf.
Yeah, hopefully we see each other in flesh.
Or at Greech.
Or at Greech. That's a different story.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Yeah, same. Bye-bye.